All right. So welcome everyone to this Monash Cybersecurity Seminar. So today we are happy to welcome Dimitris Kolonelos, who is a PhD student at IMDA Software Institute and Universidad Politécnica de Madrid in Spain. And he is broadly interested in various cryptographic aspects with a current interest in compressing primitives for large-scale applications such as scalable blockchains. And he's particularly interested in cryptographic primitives like vector commitments, accumulators or sets, and succinct argument systems. And today he will talk to us about zero knowledge proofs for set membership. So over to you, Dimitris. Thank you.
Okay, so let me first share my screen. Okay, I guess you see my screen, right?
Yeah. All good. Thank you.
Okay, yes. So, first of all, thanks for the nice introduction, Mohammed, and of course for the invitation and the opportunity to speak to the seminar. So, also thanks everyone for attending. And so I'm going to talk about work of ours that is going to appear next month on financial crypto. And it has to do with zero knowledge proofs for the problem of set membership. So this is a joint work with Daniel Benaros from KEDID, Matteo Campanelli from Warburg University, Dario Fiore, who's my advisor at IMDEA, and Kobe Gurkan from Ethereum Foundation and C-Labs. Okay, so yes, maybe before I start, let me declare that You can interrupt me at any point of the presentation. So I would be glad to answer questions at this point. This, I guess, is supposed to be somehow interactive. So yes, please ask questions whenever you want. So, okay, so we'll start with some motivating example about the set membership problem. And yes, so I'm going to talk first about a use case that comes from the blockchain area, and it has to do with a UTXO set. So I assume some of you or many of you should be aware, should be familiar with the UTXO set. In any case, I will say a few things. So in some type of in some types of blockchains, as for example in Bitcoin, we have the transactions are, for the transactions, we have unspent coins. So in the blockchain, there are unspent coins, which are the coins that are valid to be spent. And these are called more formally UTXOs, unspent transaction outputs. So these are the only coins that are valid to be spent. Now, if we take all of these coins and we put them into a set, this forms the so-called UTXO set, which is the set of all the coins that can be spent. Now why is this coin, is this UTXO set useful? Well, it is useful for a person that wishes to validate transactions. So what this person, the validator, should do is to store this UTXO set, and then at the time of the transaction, just check whether the coin that's about to be spent is indeed part of the UTXO set. So with this, the validator ensures that the coin that's about to be spent has not been spent in the past. It is valid to be spent. Okay, now the drawback of this model, although of course it is much more efficient than actually searching the whole blockchain, but the drawback is that the validator should store this UTXO set. And this is causes some scalability problems, because the UTXO set is always getting growing larger and larger. More UTXOs are added constantly to the UTXO set. So the validator should store something that does not scale well with the number of the users. Now, in order to overcome this this limitation, there has been proposed a solution that is related to, if to the, if you have heard, the stateless blockchain framework. And this involves the use of a cryptographic primitive that's called an accumulator. So accumulators are objects, are cryptographic primitives that allow you to take a set and create a small digest, a small binding digest of the set. And that, so at the same time, you can create a membership witness for each element of the set. So now the model is that the validator, instead of storing the whole UTXO set, he should store only this very, very small digest, binding digest of the set, and the spender is responsible for creating and sending a membership witness together with the transaction. So this is a membership witness for the coin that is owned by the spender, that is spent. So now the validator, instead of what the validator now has to do, is to check whether this membership witness is indeed valid with respect to the coin. And for this, he uses the verification equation of the accumulator. So the key property that makes this scalable, that makes this better than the previous simple UTXO model without the accumulator, is that accumulators are succinct, meaning that the accumulated digest that is created is much, much smaller than the actual initial set, the UTXO set. Actually, in most cases, accumulating digests are are constants, are like a few bits. And of course, that the verification here, the verification equation of the accumulator, is much faster than actually searching the whole set. Okay, and this is with the traits. Now for the security of this primitive, we demand, of course, that nobody should be able to create false membership witnesses for elements that are not in the set. So this should be impossible. And fortunately, there are nice constructions in the literature. This object is well studied in cryptography. So we have some constructions that are based on Merkle trees or Merkle trees themselves. Then we have some constructions that are called RSA accumulators, are working over RSA or in general hidden under groups. And this is the accumulators that we're going to use in this talk. And then there are some accumulators from pairings and accumulators from lattices. So in general, the takeaway is that these primitives are well studied. They're kind of, for the past 3 decades, so on. And we have some nice constructions that we can use. So now we go to the second component, let's say, of the title, which was the zero knowledge. Actually, it was the first component of the title. So zero knowledge has to do with privacy, and I will try to explain this concept again through a use case. So imagine now that we are in the same type of blockchains, in the UTXO type blockchains, and the use case is that we have a prover that wishes to prove to a verifier that she owns a coin, an unspent coin, a valid coin. But she wants to do this in an anonymous way without betraying her identity. So naively, what she would do to convince a verifier would be just to send her secret key and say that, look, this is my secret key. It corresponds to the coin. Since I know the secret key, this means that I can spend the coin. The coin is mine. And of course, together with the membership witnesses, as we said, in order for the verifier to check that this coin is unspent. So now the verifier, what would have to do is to verify that indeed this membership witness is valid, of course, and that the secret key indeed corresponds to the coin. But of course, we cannot let this happen. We said that this is supposed to be anonymous. So we cannot give out, of course, the secret key. We cannot give out the the coin, because the coin is what betrays the identity of the prover, and even the membership witness can leak some information about the identity of the prover. So for that, we need to hide all of these values, and what we do instead is to use a hiding cryptographic commitment to commit to the coin, and then the prover sends the hiding commitment of her coin to the verifier instead. And also she uses this this object that's called zero knowledge proofs. So she creates a zero knowledge proof, which is a primitive that allows the prover to prove the statement of these two verifications to the verifier, but in a way that nothing else is leaked except for the fact of the statement. So this is the key property that allows for privacy, for anonymity. It is that these zero knowledge proofs do not leak anything else except for the statement. And in this case, the statement has to do with the specific case of the anonymous coin possession. So if we abstract a bit away from the previous, as the title of course says, we focus in this work in zero knowledge proofs for the specific problem of set membership. So a bit more abstractly, this means that we have a set with some elements inside and the prover that wishes to prove membership of her element to the verifier, of her committed element to the verifier. But of course in zero knowledge. And but the thing is that set membership itself is in almost never, at least in, I'm not aware of any application where set membership alone is useful. So in all cases, in each case, we need to, we would like to prove a set membership that our element is a part of some set plus some extra properties. Some extra properties that may be arbitrary. So this means that the zero knowledge proof that we use for the set membership should be able to treat efficiently both the set membership statement, the set membership relation, plus arbitrary statements. And this, of course, extends to non-membership. As for example, we have a blacklist, and the prover first wants to prove, she needs to prove that her element is not part of the blacklist, and then prove something, some other properties about her element. Okay, then in the paper we describe some applications for the set membership and non-membership in zero knowledge. One has to do, I think it's the most popular, maybe has to do with privacy preserving UTXO type cryptocurrencies. This is like the Zcash type of cryptocurrencies. And then we describe some applications that have to do with whitelists and asset transfers over the blockchain. Then we describe an interesting application which has to do with anonymous broadcast. And this application is, the interesting part of that is that anonymous broadcast crucially needs fast proving times. The proving time of the protocol should be very fast, should be very efficient. Then some know your customer applications. Then we refer to some blacklists for financial identities. And of course, in blacklists, we need set non-membership. We need to prove that an element is a non-member to the blacklist. And finally, we also describe a fix to a recent, kind of recent, zero coin implementation vulnerability that was exposed in 2019. So these are some applications. You can find more details in the paper. And now we will continue with our goals. So before going to our actual constructions, I would like first to say a few things about the goals that we would like to achieve with this zero knowledge proof for set membership. So, of course, the goals are the usual ones for every zero knowledge. It has to do with succinctness, efficiency and modularity. So succinctness means that the proof should be short. We should have as short as we can proofs. Efficiency means that we need fast proving and verification time. And yes, here I would say I need to note that in this work, when we say efficient, we focus more on the proving time. So verification time, I can say that it is kind of result, it is very, very optimized. If you need a great verification time, for example, the most optimal scheme that we know would be the growth 16. And but the thing is that this comes with sometimes with large proving time overhead. So in any case, this work focuses on improving the proving time while maintaining a small verification time. And then modularity, which says that the set membership protocol should be able to compose well with other protocols. So where does this come from? Well, the idea for modularity, the idea that modularity is significant came for us from another paper, the Lego Snark paper from Campanelli et al. That from 2019, in which the main approach, the main idea is that if you have a relation, a statement, a complex relation that you want to prove in zero knowledge, instead of trying to prove it with a single gadget, try to decompose your relation as much as you can, so that you can use the most efficient proof system that you have, the most efficient gadgets, zero knowledge gadgets that you have for each sub-relation, and at the end integrate all of these sub-proofs. So this means that these proofs here can use different proof system, different proof systems. So with this, what we gain is that this boosts the overall efficiency of the proof, since we, as we said, we use the most optimized protocol for the sub-relation. Now, yes, a technical remark here is that in order for this integration to be able to happen, all of this protocol need to refer to the same commitment. It is important that all of the protocols refer to the same committed element, to the same commitment. Now, specifically in our case, we have a protocol, as we said, for the set membership relation, and then we need another protocol for arbitrary statements. So the thing is that for arbitrary statements, there already exists a lot of nice general purpose zero knowledge proofs, proof systems that we wouldn't like to lose. So there is a great, there's an amazing, I would say, line of work the past at least 5 to 10 years that are, so we have very nice constructions for general purpose zero knowledge proofs. We do not want to lose them. We do not want to reinvent protocols for the arbitrary relation. And instead, what we want is that our set membership protocol should be able to compose with them, should be able to compose well with the existing state-of-the-art protocols. And this is why we say that modularity is important. So now, let's have a look of the state-of-the-art in the set membership in zero-knowledge problem. So that basically, there are two main approaches. One that uses Merkle trees as an accumulator, and then zero knowledge snarks to provide anonymity, to enhance with zero knowledge. And the other approach is RSA accumulators combined with Sigma protocols. So the first approach, which is a approach of zero coin protocol, and for this approach, for the second one, RSA accumulators and Sigma protocols for the zero knowledge proof. And yes, I was saying that the set membership protocol itself is quite efficient, is nice and efficient, but the problem is on the composition with proof systems for the arbitrary relation. So this means that here at the second approach, it gets inefficient to prove arbitrary statements. So our result, high level, our result is to combine the best of both worlds, meaning that we want to maintain the efficient zero knowledge proof for set membership, but to make it efficient to compose well with other proof systems as zero knowledge NARCs for arbitrary statements. So then we extend to non-membership, and for that we use RSA accumulators for the data structure. So here the technical part of the talk begins. This is where I will explain the construction of our constructions. So I will start with explaining a bit how RSA accumulators are working. Then we will discuss an existing zero knowledge proof for RSA accumulators. Then our results are described, our constructions. And finally, we will see some performance and comparison. So our schemes have been implemented, so the performance and comparison is concrete, is for concrete numbers. It's not asymptotic. Okay, so RSA accumulators, as the title indicates, are working over RSA groups. So I assume some familiarity with RSA groups, but in short, for an RSA group to be sampled, we need a large integer, a modulus n, that it is a product of two primes. This prime should be absolutely kept secret, otherwise we lose security for our schemes. And we also need a random generator from the group in order to start with our accumulator. So first of all, RSA accumulators are working only for sets of primes. And this means that they can provide security, they can be proven secure only if the set contains prime numbers. So this seems kind of restrictive, but we will come back later to this limitation and see how to overcome. We will see how to overcome this limitation in a few slides. So we have our set of primes. First thing to do is to accumulate our set. And this happens, this is just G, the generator, to the product of all primes. And this is the accumulated digest. Of course, every operation happens modulo n. This is why we need the modulus n. Then for the membership witness, for an element pi, for the ith element, the membership witness is simply g to the product of all primes, except for the prime that we're proving membership. And finally, the verification is straightforward. It's just one exponentiation. It is W, the membership witness, to the PI should be able to the accumulated digest. Should be equal to the accumulated digest. So I think correctness is very easy to see. It's straightforward. Now for security, there is an assumption, the strong RSA assumption, which is well studied nowadays for RSA groups. And security comes from this assumption. Now for the traits of this accumulator and why these are the reasons that made us drew our attention and made us see these accumulators. So the benefits are, First of all, everything is constant sized, the parameters, the accumulated digest is just one group element, the membership witness is just one group element. And then there are some functionalities of these RSA accumulators that were shown by Bonnet, by a paper of Bonnet et al. From 2019. And they're related to the stateless blockchain. So they're useful for the stateless blockchain. So in RSA accumulators, we have efficient and public digest and membership updates. This is possible to efficiently and publicly update these values. And update means, as the set changes, we can update our the digest and the membership witnesses without having to compute them from scratch. So this is very important for the stateless blockchain framework. And this is more or less what we described in the first slides, the framework. So finally, also RSA accumulators can support non-membership witnesses, which is important for the zero knowledge proof for said non-membership. Okay, now, as we said, there already exists a protocol for RSA accumulators, a zero knowledge proof for said membership that uses RSA accumulators. This is a protocol of Cummins and Siaskaya, which dates back to 2002. So this protocol is, although it is nice and highly efficient, it uses RSA accumulators, of course, the main drawback, the main problem of this protocol is that the commitment of our committed element should commit in a large prime order group, in a say fairly large prime order group of at least 519 bits. So this is a problem because, as we said, this commitment is what lets the said membership protocol to communicate with the outside world, with any other protocol for arbitrary statements. So this means that if we were to use a general purpose proof system for arbitrary relations, as for example, say bullet proofs, then we would have to make bullet proofs work in elliptic curves of at least 519 bits. So this gets quite inefficient. This makes the composition inefficient. Now, there's another detail, again, that for security reasons, the set itself should contain primes that are fairly large, of at least 259 bits. And since we have large primes in our set, this makes the whole accumulation process quite inefficient. So for our construction, we built on the Cummins and Siaskaya protocol. This was our starting point. So we use RSA accumulators, but we managed to bring our commitments to a small elliptic curve group. And by small, I mean basically to any elliptic curve group, any standard elliptic curve you want to use, you may use it. And finally, we are working for sets of arbitrary integers. So how can we achieve this? How can we make RSA accumulators to work for a set of arbitrary integers? We said that RSA accumulators are secure only for primes. Well, there's a folklore technique which says that use a hash to prime function and map each integer of the set to a unique prime number. So this hash to prime function is a collision resistant function that maps integers to primes. So after that, we have transformed our set to a set of primes, and we are ready to accumulate our primes. So since this hash to prime function is collision resistant, this final digest here is binding for it's a binding commitment for the initial set of integers. Okay, then of course we have a prover, as we said, that wishes to prove set membership. So first thing that the prover should do is to compute a membership witness for her element with respect to the accumulator. And after that, we are ready to start with our protocol. And for our protocol, we need two groups, an elliptic curve group and an RSA group. So the elliptic curve group, as we said, can be of standard size, can be the order of the group, can be of standard size of say 256 or 384, or in any case, the elliptic curve is a standard one. So as we said, in the RSA group, we have already computed, and this is a public value, the accumulated digest. And first thing that the prover needs to do is to compute a commitment for her element. So she has an element, U, an arbitrary integer, and wants to prove that it is a member of the set. First thing is to commit to this integer in the elliptic curve group. And then she commits to the corresponding prime of this element in the RSA group in order to prove the verification equation of the accumulator. So this is done by a root protocol. Of course, it is a zero knowledge protocol. It is based like, it is a sigma protocol, sigma-like protocol. It is somehow extracted from the Kamen's and Lisiaskaya's protocol, and it proves the verification equation of the accumulator for this prime P. Of course, we don't know that this P is connected to U, and this is what we need to prove. It's the next thing that we need to prove. We need to prove that this P is indeed the hash of U. So we need to prove a hash relation in zero knowledge, and this is the hash protocol, which is more efficient to happen in the elliptic curve group. So the hash protocol here could be any general purpose protocol that can prove hash equalities, hash function. Yes. So until now we know that U is hash to prime to a prime P, and the prime P is indeed in the accumulated set. Now the problem is that until now, this P on the left and on the right on the two groups are completely independent. They are not related one to each other. And what this leaves a trivial attack for soundness, an attacker that can basically put a different P on the left and on the right. So in order to prevent this, we need to apply a third protocol, which proves exactly this, that the third protocol proves that the commitments on the elliptic curve and on the RSA groups and on the RSA group commit to the same element P. This is a proof of equality for the opening of two commitments between RSA and the elliptic curves and the elliptic curve groups. So this is the MODEC protocol. And with this, this concludes our proof. Set membership protocol. But there's a caveat on the previous. For simplicity, I said that we have a proof of equality, while in fact, it's not a proof of equality over the integers, but instead the proof of equality modulo the order of the group. So what we can prove with this proof of equality unavoidably is P equals P star modulo Q. So we have to deal with that. First, let's see what problems can cause this modulo Q can cause. So this can cause problems in soundness. So if we have a malicious party that wants to cheat the verifier to break the soundness of the protocol, what he could do would be to commit normally in the elliptic curve group to P, but then instead of committing to the corresponding P star in the RSA group, he can commit to another P star prime. And as long as P star prime equals P modulo Q, then he can pass the verification undetected. So this attack cannot be detected since P P equals P star prime modulo Q. And whenever this happens, P equals P star prime modulo Q, but not over the integers, we say that this is a collision. So what we need to do now is to eliminate these collisions and prove instead that P equals P star over the integers. And I remind that P is the element that is committed in the elliptic curve group and P star the element that is committed in the RSA group. We need to prove it. We need to be able to ensure that this happens over the integers. So in order to eliminate the collisions, the first thing, the first step is to look at them, to analyze them, to see how many of them can, how many of them exist, how many of them can an adversary find. And the thing is that we are not completely in the dark. We have some, we already have some information from the root protocol. So the root protocol, first observation is that the root protocol proves a verification equation of the accumulator. And this means that at least P star should be a product of some primes from the accumulated set. So this comes from the RSA accumulator security. So already we see that this P star cannot be something arbitrary. At least it should be a product of some primes from the set. Now there's a second observation that comes from the root protocol, which says that from a single inspection of some values, of the size of some values of the root protocol, we can get an upper bound on the size of P star. So from these two observations, if we combine them, the conclusion is that P star can be a product of at most D primes from the accumulated set. So D here is a parameter that is that comes from only from the parameters of the protocol, the security parameters, the size of the primes in the set, and so on. And in any case, it's something that with plausible parameters is a very small constant, like 2 or 3, something like this. So this means that P can be a product of at most some small number of primes. And in order to eliminate the collisions, in order to eliminate them, our key idea was to fix the size of the prime. So this means that each prime now that is added in the accumulated set should have a fixed size. We do this, we achieve this by having the output of the hash function be of fixed size, of exactly new bits. And with this, and from this idea, from this, with this, from this restriction, what we get is that now P star can have only discrete sizes of mu or 2 times mu and until D times mu, but as we said, D plus 1 times mu is rejected by the root protocol. And from that, we have two cases that we analyze in the paper. One case says that if a nice inequality holds, then no collisions can happen. No collisions can happen at all. And this inequality translates to the fact that P star cannot be more than the order of the group. So in this case, collisions cannot happen. While in the second case, where this nice inequality that I'm saying has to do only with the parameters that we choose for the zero knowledge proof. So if this nice inequality cannot hold because we cannot choose the parameters accordingly, then what we can do is to make these prime numbers generate randomly meaning that we have to model the hash function as a random oracle, and then collisions happen only with negligible probability. So we have an extension to set non-membership, and this is simply by replacing the root protocol that verifies the membership witness with a co-prime protocol that verifies a non-membership witness. So if we simply switch between these two sigma protocols, we get a non-membership protocol. And here's a summary of our constructions. We only describe the first row of this table, which is, as we said, is working for sets of arbitrary primes. It uses RSA accumulators. It uses a hash protocol. And then there's a second row that we didn't describe, which is basically, it assumes that we already have sets of primes. So if we have a set that, if we have an application that can tolerate values of the set to already be prime numbers, then we can use a more efficient construction that can get rid of the hash protocol. And this hash protocol is costly to happen in the elliptic curve. So if we already have primes, we don't need the hash function, and we instead need the range protocol, which is much more efficient. It is more efficient than the hash protocol. Finally, we have a third construction, which is of completely different spirit. It is it uses the edrax vector commitment. It is working over elliptic curves with pairings. It uses pairings, and the advantage of this scheme is that it also hides the set. The set is also hiding. And of course, the drawback, which is the usual drawback when we're working over elliptic curves, is that now the parameters have linear size, linear in the size of the set. And there are two equivalent for the non-membership. As we said, one equivalent for a set of arbitrary elements and one for set of primes. Okay, and the last remark is that we described our protocol with RSA groups. RSA groups need a trusted setup. They need to be, this modulus n should be structured, should be a product of two primes. Somebody has to generate these primes and then destroy them. So these RSA groups need a trusted setup. We can instead have a transparent instantiation of our scheme if we instead use class groups. So class groups do not need a trusted setup. And if we replace RSA groups with class groups and specifically use a transparent proof system for the hash protocol, a transparent proof system can be bulletproof, or there are also recent works in transparent proof systems for this that can be used. So if we specifically use a transparent scheme and class groups, then we have a transparent instantiation for the set membership protocol. So of course it has some technical details in order to work, but these details can be found in the paper. So basically that's it with our constructions. I don't know how much time do I have, but
you can continue for a few more minutes.
Okay. I will say some things about the implementation, the performance, and some comparisons. So our schemes have been implemented. The code is publicly available. There's a link at the end of the last slide. The implementation is on Rust. And regarding the cryptographic parameters, for the elliptic curve, we use BLS 12381. For the RSA group, we use 2048 bits RSA groups of 2048 bits. For the hash protocol, specifically, first of all, we use the hash function of Blake, the hash function Blake2S, and for the zero knowledge proof, we use a variant of Growth 16 that comes from Lego Snack, the Lego Growth 16. So we didn't use Growth 16 because it does not compose in the sense that we described with the set membership protocol. So we needed to switch to another variant, the Lego Growth 16, which is very similar to Growth. Then for the range protocol, we have a bunch of instantiations. Specifically in these slides, I put only the instantiation of with bulletproofs. Okay, and this is a table of comparison. We compare our schemes with the approach of Merkle trees and zero knowledge snarks. We have first thing is to compare to the generic SHA-256 Merkle trees and with Growth 16. So general observations, general comments about the performance of our schemes is that what we wanted to achieve is, first of all, to improve the proving time, as we said, and this is what we did achieve. And for proof size and verification time, we knew we could not compare with Growth 16. This would be infeasible. But still we have proof sizes and verification time that are practical in a practical range. And on top of that, we also improve on CRS size and RAM consumption for our schemes. So concretely, if we were to compare to with the SHA-2 Merkle trees, we have a proving time improvement of for the first scheme. So for the first scheme that works for arbitrary elements, we have an improvement of 16 to 32 times, depending on the size of the Merkle tree. And for the second scheme, here in the second column that works for set of prime, we have an improvement in order of magnitude more of 127 to 250 times. This is the improvement in proving time. So then if we were to compare with Pedersen hashes, Merkle trees that are from Pedersen hashes, which is, I think, the state of the art right now in the area, we still would have an improvement of 2 to 3.7 times for proving time of the first scheme and 15 to 28.5 for the second scheme. Now for set non-membership, our schemes have pretty much the same performance as the set membership. But the thing is that, on the other hand, Merkle trees, the approach of Merkle trees, would have an overhead of at least 2, because in order to have Merkle trees that provide set to provide non-membership, that can prove non-membership, we have to choose different and more complicated Merkle trees. We have to change the data structure to, for example, interval Merkle trees or sparse Merkle trees, and this would cause an overhead in the overall scheme. And the last thing I'm going to mention is that we also have an aggressive optimization on our schemes. And this is, if we take the assumption that if we make an assumption that choosing an exponent for a generator from 1 to the order of the group and choosing an exponent from 1 to 2 to the 2L, if we choose these exponents randomly, if these two experiments are indistinguishable, then we can have a more efficient, we can have an optimization for our scheme, because we can choose our exponents, our random exponents from a smaller set and have smaller exponents. The smaller exponents we have, the more efficient exponentiations we can make. So this makes our scheme our schemes even more efficient, this assumption, but of course at the cost that now for the zero knowledge property, we have to take computational assumption, so we lose the statistical zero knowledge property. I think that's it from me. Here's the paper is on ePrint, and the implementation is also publicly available. So yes, that's it. Thank you. Thanks for the attention. And of course, I'm here for questions if there are.
Thank you very much, Dimitris. I can maybe start with a question. Could you go back to this table where you had the efficiency, and I think you were showing like the parameters, and you said that like constant site parameters, I think you were saying.
In which table?
Before this one.
I think it's the first one. Okay. Here?
No, even before this, you had like O of one for the parameters.
Oh, okay. Yes.
This one. So what exactly is meant here by these O of one parameters? Is it like the proof length is constant size? Or?
No, the parameters of it's basically the parameters of the scheme. So take for example that these are the parameters of the accumulator. So if we have a set
size grows, you can still use exact same parameters.
Yes. So for RSA accumulators, we just need a group sampled and a random generator. For accumulators over pairings, we need it's an open problem. We always need linear size parameters. So the larger the set gets, the larger the parameter get.
Mm-hmm. I see. Okay. Thank you. Do we have any question from the audience? Anyone?
So I have a question. Thank you for the nice talk. My question is for this comparisons, the following table that you showed, right? So in the first column, it's your protocol and you're proving a set membership, right?
Yes.
But the set membership is proved with the RSA accumulator protocol.
Yes.
And so what are you proving with the discrete log commitment? The elliptic curve one.
Okay, yes. So for the set membership to work, we need we also need to prove either a hash, for example, in the first column, we need to prove a hash computation. So if you have an arbitrary element and you want it to be accumulated with an RSA accumulator, you have to map it with a hash function to a prime number. So this mapping, you have to prove it. And this is what we prove in the elliptic curve.
Basically, you prove just this hash is computed correctly.
Yes, exactly. This needs to be proven in zero knowledge. This cannot be. This should be hided, so it should be also.
But this hash is you are using like a symmetric key.
The Blake 2S.
Blake 2S, right.
So you
prove this using a kind of general circuit protocol over the
Yes. I mean it's modular. You can use in our case we use the Lego Growth 16.
We also
have we had some benchmarks for bulletproofs also in order to have transparent instantiation. But in any case, you can use pretty much each general purpose system that you want for this computation.
Yeah, I see. Okay. All right, thank you.
You too.
Any other questions, anyone? Yeah, I'll ask one last question. So you mentioned about this, like in the soundness argument, you said that this P star can be a product of primes, right?
Yes, it's
yeah,
here.
Yeah. But don't we prove that P star is in the set S where the S only contains primes?
Yes. So, yes. So the thing is that RSA accumulators, this is something that I didn't mention, but RSA accumulators can also provide membership witnesses for products of primes.
Ah, okay.
Yes. So when you have an exponent that, when you have an exponent that a membership witness and an exponent that verifies it, this means that this is either a single prime or a product of some primes. This is a kind of useful property for accumulators because you can batch many membership witnesses with a single group element. But in our case, in this case, it was kind of adversarial. I mean, because the freedom that you have, that P star can be a product of some primes, in our case, it was not, it was against us.
Mm-hmm. So if you want, you can make that protocol prove that P star is actually just one of the primes, not a product of primes.
Yes. This is this is what we're trying to make for the soundness. This is
without your soundness argument, can you make the original this root protocol prove that P star is just a single prime, not a product of primes?
I think no.
Ah, okay. Okay.
At least not in zero knowledge. If you don't check that, then I guess if you were to apply a primality proof, you would be able to do that. But primality proofs are kind of inefficient.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were to prove that you have an exponent that verifies, and this exponent is prime with a primality zero knowledge proof, then yes, I guess you would be able to, but primality proofs are kind of tricky.
Okay.
Can I ask another question? So,
yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. So for your protocol where you prove both the RSA accumulator membership and also the hash, so if you were to prove only the RSA part without the hash, would it be much more efficient than your current protocol? Or?
Yes, but so there are some tricky parts that if you were to prove in zero knowledge that some exponent verifies, this exponent could be also trivial. It could be the one or minus one, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot prove that something is different than one of or minus one, or not something is not one or minus one unless you prove it in zero knowledge. This was also a problem in the previous proof of Kamenis and Lisiaskaya. So if you were to prove I'm saying this exponentiation here only, P star can be one. It can be the trivial exponent.
Yeah.
So this is why you somehow need to prove something else as a range or in our case a hash for this P star.
Okay, yeah. But you are saying that basically if you replace the hash proof with something else that is more efficient, it will significantly improve your
protocol. Yes.
Okay. All right.
This is what we do with the range proof ranges somehow.
Ah, yeah, those other approaches. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Yeah, thank you.
All right. Yeah, I guess there are no more questions. So thank you very much, Dimitris. And
thank you too.
We can end this session here. So hope to see you everyone in the next session. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the invitation again.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you.